And you are back on the Tortoise and Hare Experience. We just heard the song Junk Nation by The Dead Good. And here's the thing. You may have remembered that song from about 2 years ago, because that's when we had the band on.
That's right. Isabel was pregnant then.
Yeah, yeah. We are going to catch up with them in a little bit. But before we do that, we do have a guest. She is an actress and a model, probably at the same time.
A singer as well.
A singer as well. Who do we have on?
The unbelievably gorgeous, statuesque.
Very statuesque.
There are words that describe her that should be in their own, like, you know, urban dictionary.
Yeah.
Seriously, one of the most beautiful women that I've ever seen in my life, Lauren London. Just such a pleasure to be here.
Thank you so much for having me on your show.
Cool. Now, with every
it's
show...
It's just Maybelline and dental floss. But thank you.
Now, with every show, we always like to start it off with an experience. And this is always the fun part of who goes first, either me or Max. Do you want me to go first, or should...
You know what? I'm going to go first because you talk too much.
It's
no, it's true. He does. He talks and he talks and he talks, and then my segment is like, beep, beep, and that's it.
Well, let's face it. The show's all about me.
No, the show is all about our guests.
Oh, that's right.
Well, you are incredibly, impossibly gorgeous yourself.
Oh, thank you so much. She's talking to Turtle. But
I'm talking to Max. Everybody go look up who Max is.
Oh, wow. Thank you so much.
If I was, what? What happened?
Nothing. I'm like, if you were a lesbian, maybe? I don't know.
But I'm not.
Well, thank you.
I heard Bruce Jenner got, 10 million, 100 million followers last night?
Oh, really? Well, he, Caitlin.
Caitlin.
No longer Bruce.
So I'm thinking of changing my gender.
Okay.
Oh. Become a girl.
No. Wait a minute. You are a girl.
Oh, I am? Oh, okay. I'm joking. God bless her. More power to her.
Yes, that's true. I've had some exciting experiences going on. I went out to Pennsylvania to shoot this film called The Wendigo. And for those of you who are not familiar, it's an old legend about a deer that kind of becomes a human. And, you know, it's kind of folklore, so they say. But I was out in the middle of the woods. I had to hike 8 miles into the woods and through streams, and there was storm, and it was just absolutely craziness, because my idea of camping is putting the blanket on the floor at the Four Seasons. Yeah. You know, for real. I just, you know, me and the outdoors, if it's not in the ocean, I'm just, I don't know. I'm not that comfortable. I'm like, it's hard. Are you a big camper, Turtle?
I'm not, because I used to go camping in the Marine Corps.
Right.
And for me, it was just like, that was enough for me. I was just like, look, it's not called camping unless there's a shower. You know, and in the toilet, you know, and baby wipes.
Yeah, they kept talking about, you know, if you have to go to the restroom, you just go to that tree over there. And I was, absolutely not. That's not going to happen in my lifetime. So forget it.
Not only that, but like if you go poop outside, like think about it. Like most people are not as like healthy as you just because you have such a restricted diet. But like there are people that eat all these processed foods. And it gets, you know, into the earth through, you know, taking a dump.
Right. So don't do that. People, you're destroying us through your bad taste in food.
Right. So unless you're eating all organic, like all like natural things, don't poop out in the wilderness. That's just a PSA.
Yeah. Please.
From here.
Thank you.
The Tortoise and the Hare Experience.
Right. But it was a great experience being out there. Unbelievable cast. This cast was from New York, most of them. I was the only one that flew in from Los Angeles.
What is it
called? Wendigo.
The Wendigo.
The Wendigo. Yeah. Very.
What's it about?
It's about this deer. Right. That, you know, it's deer and person, can't really tell you that much because it'll give it away. But there's a lot of blood. There's a lot of screaming. There's, you know, good times to be had.
When is it coming out?
It will be out in September, I believe. I believe that's when they're looking at it.
I can't wait to see it.
Hey, well, we just got the dead good in here. Welcome, guys.
They'll be on in a bit.
They will. Thank you for joining us.
The experience that I've been going through has been, I just got some more dental work done.
Exciting stuff.
Very exciting. Yeah. As everyone knows, I'm a fan of dentalness.
Pain? Of pain?
Well, you got to go through the pain. Like, think about it. You got a cavity. What are you going to do? You know? And so I through this, I found out that my teeth are very sensitive. So it's like they had to like poke me like six times in like the right and like seven times in the left just to really numb me, because I could feel that drill. And that's what kills me, is it's not the sound of the drill, it's just like the smell and everything.
Oh yeah, there is a smell.
Yeah.
I would have been happy to do your dental work for you.
Oh yeah. No, what? I want a professional.
Come on, that would have been a good time.
And so one of
got
the
a drill
when that was done with Phil X.
Yeah, that's right.
One of the things that they told me was that it was going to take 2 weeks for my teeth to kind of get back to normal. So I just did it 2 weeks ago, and my teeth are still not normal. When I drink, I'm a big fan of drinking like cold water, cold milk.
You shouldn't do that. You like shouldn't that. Drink cold water. Should be room temperature.
Yeah, I know. I should either be drinking room temperature or hot water. But you know what? There's nothing like an ice cold glass of something, whether it's, you know, water with, mm-hmm. I love water with just tons of ice. And then like I eat the ice right after. I know that's bad.
Oh, wow.
For your teeth. But, you know, those are the things that are the luxuries of my life for right now. And I can't do that. And what kills me is I can't drink milk. I like drinking chocolate milk. And it hits my teeth, especially when I brush my teeth, too. When I'm brushing my teeth, my teeth just get really sensitive. So it's been really...
Are you using, like, the Sensodyne?
I'm using that with baking soda. As you know, I'm a huge fan of baking soda.
Yeah, I am, too. That's all I use, actually. Peroxide and baking soda.
That's very good.
So, yeah, so right now, it's been real tough for me to eat things. Like, I was eating these chips, and that was kind of even tough, too.
Yeah.
Doing that. So just,
should we have somebody pre-chew your food for you?
No, that's gross.
Well, you are a turtle.
Regurgitated. Gross.
Yeah. I worry about you.
As you should. The entire world should.
I don't know what you're eating, what you're drinking. Comes in here, he's not in a happy mood. Jeez.
I'm usually in a good mood. The only things that upset me as of late is just, as everyone knows, Noho 2 Studio is going through some construction work outside.
Yes.
And which, you know, it leads to a lot of things. I really haven't been able to get a band in here from my other show that I do, just due to where they have to park and they got to lug their gear. And a lot of people have told me, they're like, Turtle, bands are so used to it. They're so used to, you know, these obstacles. But it's just like I'm doing it too, and then I come here, and then I got to go through that on top of the band. So I've been a little frustrated by what they're doing, and that's supposedly going to happen for 2 more years.
2 years.
Yeah, they're building a sound wall, and me and Zombie Dave were like, "Why a sound wall? Like, what?
Right. Is it too loud on Burbank Boulevard?"
Yeah, like we don't get
it. Yes, it is.
So that's one of the things that's just kind of just been in the back of my mind. Kind of affecting like my vibe, you know. I come in usually with a good attitude and everything like that, but just like I gotta lug some of this gear in.
Yeah, and I'm noticing that you're coming in with less and less clothes.
Well, it's getting hot. It's getting hot. So finally, like when the winter comes,
he's got a white beater T-shirt on.
Yeah. That's right.
Well, I've been watching a lot of Sopranos too. So
really,
yeah. Now, yeah,
you're not even Italian.
I'm not. But here's the thing, too. Like,
I'm worried about you.
The Sopranos. Some people, get this, have never seen it. I'm one of those people that haven't seen it.
Mm-hmm.
So I get to watch it for the first time as a new viewer. You know, and one of the things that I picked on what was the wife beater. Like, that's all they wear. You know, and I don't know. I kind of picked that up right now. Like, oh man, I should be wearing more wife beaters. I really don't like wear them enough.
It makes me nervous.
Edie Falco is so fantastic in that show. I haven't seen all the episodes, but I love her in Nurse Jackie.
Yeah. Oh, that's one of the best shows.
Oh,
I love that.
Oh, my God.
I love the show that was on right before Nurse Jackie, Shameless.
Oh, that's just as good.
That is an incredible show. Two shows I want to do.
Defies all convention. It's
William H. Macy is on that show, and it's just... It's outrageous. It's how they get away with this stuff on... Yeah, it's...
You can't believe the vernacular they use and what they do. And I guess because it's cable, you can pretty much get away with it, whatever you want.
Right.
But I love Shameless. It's on Sunday nights, too. But
right before.
On demand. I always watch it next day or 2 days later. But yeah, Shameless is awesome.
It's funny because when I...
And episodes.
I was... doing cable back in the day. I used to do a show on HBO.
I mean, back in the day, you looked 12.
Oh, thank you. it was Dream On with John Landis, Kevin Bright, and Marta Kaufman. And that show was like, you know, just changed everything for television and what we could get away with. And now there's like, you know, there are no rules. It's crazy. There's sex on the sinks and in the toilets and, you know, children doing cocaine. And it's just really
well, no, but everything else. I love cable TV because you can do whatever you want, get away with murder, essentially. Mm-hmm. But I think mainstream television insults the intelligence of the average viewer. But I guess most people want to just sit there and veg out. But when you watch cable TV, you got to sit there and think and follow a story, pretty much. Follow the story week to week. And like I said earlier, they defy convention. And I just think it's fantastic. Cable and Netflix and now Amazon.
Mm-hmm. That's true.
So me and Max share an experience that we're going through. Would you like to share an experience that you've been going through?
Well, I lost my cat last week.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
15 years, so I've been decimated emotionally about that. His name was King Kong.
Oh, yeah, that's a great name.
That's been rather very hard to go through. But, you know, I have another kitty, Fearless Kitty, and I have two pit bulls, the Gizzard and Moses. I had 14 cats. I rescue cats and pit bulls pretty much.
But I hope you have a big
really
house.
It's really hard, you know. When you don't have children, animals become your children. And when I took Kong in to go to the Rainbow Bridge last week, Dr. Wong said to me, I've always noticed, because she's been doing the practice for a long time, and she says, I've always noticed the people that come in here and have to do what you have to do are the ones that suffer the most, and that's because... you don't have children. The ones that have children, I notice, always are okay, almost right away. But the ones that come in, and these essentially are your children, your animals. I'm partial to animals because animals do not judge. They don't look in the past. They don't live in the future. They live in the moment.
Right.
And they don't judge you. You know, they just love you unconditionally. And I know people are going to hate me for saying this, but I don't care. I love animals more than I do human beings.
Yeah, there's...
I don't care if you have wrinkles. I don't care if you have eyelashes on. They don't care if you're ugly. They don't care if you're fat. They don't care if you're making a movie. They don't care what you do. They just love you. You know, they wait by the front door with a pillow in their mouth, like Moses does, a pillow, or a chair, or the refrigerator, if you could grab it. But you know, to share with you, to give to you. And, you know... Kitties are a little different, you know. Kitties, you know, they love you, but pretty much if you don't feed me, you know, fuck you, get out of my house.
Right. There are two cats in the studio, and you would never know it.
No,
because they never, they never show their faces.
What are their names?
I don't even know. They're new. They're
I
new
have no
kitties.
Idea. Yeah, they're bulls are over there as proof. And then there's a kitty litter thing over there. I've never had a pet before in my entire life, so...
What's wrong with you? I don't trust people who don't shop at the Goodwill or who don't have pets.
I shop at Goodwill. That's all I can afford.
All right.
I have a dog.
I love the Goodwill.
I have a dog and children.
Oh, it's beautiful.
Really? Yeah, what Goodwill do you go to? Goodwill. Because well, that is La gorgeous.
La Brea.
Well,
La Brea, man. And Wilshire, just south of Wilshire on the west side of the street. But I know where all the Goodwills are in Beverly, on La Cienega, on Hollywood Boulevard. I know where all the Goodwills are.
Wow.
Did you see a few weeks ago...
Yes.
They did
I didn't see
that vintage. They pulled out all the Goodwill stuff that they had from the 1950s.
No.
And they sold it. It was, where was it? It might have been in Santa Monica. I want to say the Goodwill out there that they did it.
They have one in Santa Monica on Santa Monica Boulevard. Yes. Just west of Bundy.
Yeah.
On the south side of the street.
I think it was on that
it's
one.
It's on
that
the southeast corner.
Yeah.
It's a big one.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
That, big
they got all the old... You know, stuff that they still had from like the 50s and they sold it that day. One of the things that I'm finding interesting about the Goodwill as being a Goodwill shopper is that before the prices all used to be kind of the same, but now they have, they've upped their prices on certain items. Mm-hmm. And I didn't like that because it was just like I could get really good jeans, you know, that were name brand for like $5.
Oh, sure.
Yeah.
And now it's like $8.
Yeah. Well, you know where you should go over to Helping Hands for Animals on Burbank Boulevard because it all their money or most of their money goes to animal rescue. So
where is this?
Because it's right down on Burbank Boulevard. It's okay. You can't miss it because it's a bright, like yellowish building. And they have great prices over there, and it's helping the animals. So, Helping Hands for
Burbank
Animals.
Burbank and where?
Dave Rita, do you know what that?
It's east of here, right?
Yeah.
And Florence, Burbank and Florence.
I will check it out. Thank you.
You're welcome.
I didn't know that.
Yeah. Good fun stuff.
Yeah.
who knew we'd be talking about Goodwill?
Well, you know why the prices went up? I believe for two reasons. One, they started putting, they've got commercials out all the time now for Goodwill, like Target commercials, you know what I'm saying? Or, you know, like, you know, they're spending a lot of money for commercials. But before the commercials came out, I've been shopping at the Goodwill and Salvation Army since I was a child. And some members of my family, disgusted. Yet when I go to one member of my family's house, she'll say, "Oh my God, where did you get that dress?
Right.
Oh my God, where did you get those shoes?"
Yeah, and what you're wearing today
Goodwill.
Is fantastic.
Goodwill.
Love it.
And she says, "Oh, wow."
And not only that, but like when I go to Goodwill, besides finding a great deal or a great article of clothing, I feel like I'm rejuvenating this article. I'm giving it a second life.
Know? Interesting. And there's also there used to be just, you know, nice regular cars in the parking lot, You know, but now you see, I always see Mercedes in the parking lot and Lexuses, and it's really interesting how it's changed over the last couple of years because people have become aware that the clothes, a lot of them have new tags on them. I couldn't care less about the tags. I just care if it's sexy and it's cute and it's going to get me laid. No. I'm just joking. Kind of.
Right. Anyway. Do you shop at the Goodwill, Max?
I shop at Helping Hands for Animals.
Okay, that one over here.
Yeah,
okay.
I do.
Okay, what was the last article that you bought there? Just out of curiosity.
Actually, I donated a whole bunch. I actually donated almost all of my daughter's clothing.
You have a daughter?
Yeah, I have two kids.
You have kids when you're 12.
Oh, you are too sweet. I have a 22 and a 23-year-old.
Eh?
22 and 23 years old.
Are you kidding me?
That's right.
Yeah, I follow your daughter on Instagram.
Stop it, you perv.
And Facebook. Wow.
Yeah. Wow. No, my daughter is gorgeous. She is moving back here.
No way.
Yes. She's in Florida. She's moving back July 1st. So
for how long is this?
She's coming back.
Permanently?
Yeah. Wow. She's going to do the film work and music. She's a singer. Amazing and
what is
beautiful
she
model. She does a lot of like...
Just FYI, Danny, if you're listening, you have a future boyfriend waiting for you.
She never listens to my show.
Future boyfriend waiting for you right here.
Yeah, I don't think so. I don't think so, Turtle.
What is her name so I can stalk
Danny,
her on Facebook?
Danny Shaka.
Oh, I'm not going to stalk her. Danny Shaka?
Yes, Danny Shaka.
Is that Italian?
Yes. And actually, it's funny because you did a movie back in 1979 called Roller Boogie with my good friend Linda Blair.
That's the first thing I ever did.
Well, see? But my ex-brother-in-law, Rick Shaka, was in that as well. He played the guy who was like always falling.
That was all of us.
Right. Complete Control. That was his name. Complete Control Conway, I think, in that movie.
I don't remember that movie.
Well, it was 1979, so it was...
Two years ago.
Yeah, it was a good time. But that's funny because, you know, if you look on the cast list, you'll see they have the same name.
Was that an earthquake?
No, that was me looking at Danny's phone.
Oh, what a great comeback. That was great.
I have a photo of Danny if you want to. Like...
Yes, let me. May I?
Is that a new one? She just did a new photo shoot. She's fantastic. But she does a lot of...
Oh, my God.
Right? Total knockout.
Oh, my God. She's gorgeous.
Aw, thank you.
Look at that body.
And my son is pretty gorgeous himself. He's actually been sick. He was in the hospital yesterday. He's 23.
Does he like younger women?
Yes, he does.
Well, here I am. Stop it.
He loves blondes, too.
Been around before your parents were born. Anyway, she's gorgeous.
Thank you very much.
Wow. I see my son now.
Oh, yeah. Do you have my son on there?
No.
He's on Instagram.
Why do I want a guy?
He's on Instagram. I think his name on Instagram is Jesse Survive.
Jesse Survive.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah,
I like that.
Look him up. He's a big fan of Circus Survive, which my friend Ash Avelson is the manager for that band. So he's a big fan.
Very cool.
Actually has a tattoo on the back of his neck. I was telling him that he should get the Dead Good tattoo on him, but, you know, he's working on that.
Speaking of Dead Good, we're going to take a real quick break because we're going to hear another song by the Dead Good.
Oh, yeah.
By the way, if you want to go ahead and reach Lorraine, lorrainelandon.biz.
It's not Lorraine.
Lorraine?
Lorraine.
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 Lorraine. Lorraine. Lorraine. Dot biz.
Or Lorraine Landon. I'd rather you go to IMDb if you could.
Yes, because that,
that
puts our numbers
right. I will have all the links.
Mine's gone.
That's good.
I will have all the links on the show notes so people can go there. Cause
you'll forget.
It's already done. I went on to your IMDb, but the thing is it's like imdb.com/nm. Then there's like numbers and stuff like that. So it's like really tough to say over the air. So what I did is I just put all that information on the show notes. When people log on to entertheshell.com, they can get to your Twitter, your Facebook, everything.
I don't tweet. I don't know how to do that.
I know the last time you tweeted was 2010.
I don't tweet. I'm technologically impugned and I don't understand this Instagram stuff. I'm very happy for people that are, you know, can handle it, understand it, comprehend it. I don't understand even 90% of Facebook, to be honest with you, except to put up pictures of my movies, and to talk to people, a few people here and there. But I do not understand how Facebook works most of the time. I don't even know what a timeline is. I don't know what most of it is. I just know how to put pictures up of my pit bulls or myself doing film stills and, you know, videos here and there. That's all I know how to do. I don't understand what groups mean. I don't know how you can block people because when I log on, I get bombarded with...
Well, Turtle can come over and he can give you like a whole...
Oh, totally. Okay. Yeah, totally come over.
You know, there's this like running theme with drills lately. Have you noticed?
No.
Last night I was watching this new show by Steven Spielberg called The Whisperers, and there's a character on there, and his name is Drill. And then we were talking about drilling in your mouth, and now there's Drill in the song, and Phil X, you know, from The Drills. That's very strange. It's all Drill Week or something.
Okay. Well, I mean, let's keep that in mind for the show title.
You know, that's what I do. That's what I do.
Yeah. There are times where... I kind of feel like a himbo, You know?
Where, a himbo.
Yeah, you know, it's like a guy bimbo.
Yeah?
You know?
Where why is that? Are you whoring around?
No, I'm not a whore at all. You know that. No, there's just crimes.
I have high hopes for you.
Thank you. Well, I'm a classy guy. You know what I mean?
No, you're not.
Yeah, on air, I appear as, you know, a raunchy guy. But, you know, off the air, I'm really quite a gentleman. As a matter of fact, when I walked out to go get some water, who do I run into and who do I personally escort in?
I don't know.
Lorraine.
Oh, well.
Right? I saw you. And
I was busy working.
It was just right out of like a hair metal, video. She jumps out of her Beamer. You know,
it's not a Beamer.
No, what it was
Lamborghini.
That? Mercedes.
I mean,
it was just real quick. Yeah, it was just real quick. And there was a white tiger that just walked across for no apparent reason. And
Birds fly.
Yeah, and I was like, Lorraine? She's like, yeah.
The rainbow came out.
And when I hugged her, and she was so tall, which was great. It's always great being short and with tall girls.
How tall are you?
I'm 7 feet. In my head, I'm 7 feet, you know.
No.
That was fun. But I escorted her. I didn't have to do that. I could have just
No,
been like,
you didn't have to do that.
Right?
Or molest me. You didn't have to do that.
Yeah. Well, I had to.
Well, that I understand.
So I'm a complete
I was
going
to run when I saw you. I'm just kidding.
I would have caught up.
I'm totally joking. It was very nice of you. Thank you for escorting me into your beautiful studio. Thank you.
See, a classy gentleman would not have done that.
That's true. Classy. And for all of you that don't know where we're at, we are at the fantastic NoHo 2 Studios in the lovely North Hollywood on Burbank Boulevard. So if you have an event, a show that you want to put on, you want to come down here and check out some amazing art, contact Mark Doty and NoHo 2 Studios.
It's an incredible studio, very eclectic, and it is beautiful. And they have a piano, too.
Yes, yeah, it's often out of tune, but, you know, you're welcome to play it.
Or tune it. We're always accepting free tunes.
Or tune a fish.
I grew up playing classical piano.
Oh, did you?
Chopin, Tchaikovsky, Beethoven.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I composed a theme for a couple of movies as well.
Yeah, you have Captivity.
Yes, I wrote Captivity for the movie. Thank God they didn't use it in the movie, because the movie was written by a very dear friend of mine, Larry Cohen, who's done a lot of horror movies and, bestseller, Phone Booth, Cellular. I wrote the treatment for Cellular, by the way.
Oh, wow.
Mm-hmm. I'm a screenwriter as well. But I saw your piano. I thought, wow, that is so amazing. What year is it? Any idea?
I have no clue.
That piano changes often. And we have another here as well, up here.
Wow, I didn't even notice that.
And there's another keyboard up there and a drum set. And
it's a fabulous studio.
Thank you.
I mean, you could shoot a movie here easily.
And
have you ever shot a movie here?
Oh, yeah. There's been lots of shoots here.
Yeah.
I've been trying to get girls to shoot movies in here, but that's...
Well, those are not the kind of movies that we're talking about here. Turtle. Dirty Turtle. You did a film recently with a good friend of mine, Tom Churchill.
Yes.
Marilyn Monroe Zombie Hunter, right?
Yes. We haven't started shooting that yet. I'm doing a film right now with him that I'm not allowed to divulge.
Ooh.
Nobody's been signed or anything, but he's a wonderful guy.
Yes,
out of
he
his
is.
Mind, irreverent,
he's,
crazy.
He's a little crazy.
Wonderful sense of humor. And he's a good friend of yours,
right? Yes, he is. Yeah, we do a lot of the autograph shows together and around the country. And he's out of his mind.
Yes, he is. And rightly so.
You would get long good with him. We should have him on the show.
Turtle, you and him would be best buds
forever. Yeah, he's very Sopranos-ish.
Okay, cool.
Mm-hmm.
We'll eat the linguine. One of the things about Soprano that I love is anytime they have... they're eating food.
Yeah, I'm starving. Stop talking about food.
They're just naming all these different types of like Italian food. They're like, oh, the what was it? They're like, oh, the, oh man, I can't even think of it.
Pasta fagioli.
The fagioli or the whatever, blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, oh my God. As a matter of fact, I was so into it. I went and I bought spaghetti. And because I don't have a kitchen, but I like kind of created a kitchen. I have a crock pot. I'm a big crock pot person. So I got spaghetti, and then I got my own sauce, and I just threw everything together just so I can, like, watch Sopranos and eat some spaghetti and feel kind of... I know that sounds a little racist, because, mm-hmm. like, not all Italian people eat spaghetti, but...
You know, what do you eat? You don't eat anything, because you are as tiny as, like, a little piece of spaghetti.
I mostly eat salads and fish. I do eat meat occasionally, but I swim a lot. I swim 3 times a week.
Sea turtle? That's what you know. I love to swim. I always say turtle.
And I run my pit bulls every morning when I get up for about 3 miles. So, you know, I'm rather careful about what I eat, and I'm very hyper. So possibly that's why I don't know. Maybe I have a dreadful disease that I don't know about.
Oh, God forbid.
Do you have a pool in your home?
No, a very dear friend of mine has an Olympic-sized swimming pool.
Cool.
So, yeah, so I get to swim over there 2-3 times a week when I'm not filming. So
right.
I miss my pool.
I used to have a pool, too, and then I moved out, and now it's like, I miss it. But the one thing, now this is interesting, and I'm curious about your process of entering a pool. What is your process? Do you jump in, or do you slowly go in? It takes me about 30 minutes to enter a pool.
It takes me about 25 seconds. I go on the stairs, you know, because I'm screaming for, you know, I don't care if it's 100 degrees, I'm still screaming because it's too cold.
Right.
But once I'm in, no, usually it's 80 degrees, 78, 80. Once I'm in for a minute, I'm fine. It's getting in the pool that is the issue, as I'm sure you well know.
Yeah.
You know.
I think, you know, it has to deal with, and this will be interesting, is how you deal with change, you know, because that's what it is. It's a change in temperature. Mm-hmm. You know, you're changing your body temperature, especially when you jump in a pool. And me and change just do not get along.
You've been making huge changes in your life lately.
Yeah, I've been making tons of change, but this was like the past, you know mm-hmm. what I mean? This was just my metaphor for the pool when I would mm-hmm. get in, because it would take me 30 minutes just to like absorb the water and be comfortable enough to finally go underwater and start swimming. Now I can, you know, kind of jump in the water, but I have to like pre-wet myself, you know, in cold water.
Well, that's what you should do anyway.
You pee?
Ooh, gross.
No. I just get a water hose and I just go like that. And
you should always take a shower before you get into a pool, because the oils that are on your skin shouldn't mix in, you know, chlorinated water.
Well,
it's unhealthy for you. It's unhealthy for the water and the environment.
I never heard of that before.
It is.
Thank you for enlightening me.
Yeah. Well, you know, I'm all about the liquid. It's true.
And it is pool season, so for all of you with pools, just FYI.
Yeah.
Let's see. I found this interesting, and that is that you, and I'm curious, do you still find modeling boring?
I don't really model anymore.
Because you were bored of it? Or
no, because I'm a Model T. I used to model when I was very young, before your parents were born. And I couldn't stand standing still. I couldn't stand having my picture taken. To this day, I can't stand really having my photo taken. I can't stand there very long. I'm always in action. I'm always moving. That's why I love acting so much. But I did model when I was younger, and I didn't like it at all. I haven't modeled in a long time. I'm sure I have in the last couple of years for different things, but a few different things. But no, I am not a model. I'm a feature film actress and a screenwriter, but mostly an actress. I'd like to thank my fabulous manager, if I may, Joe Williamson, who is positively the greatest human being I have ever met. I tell him he's not one in a million. He is one in a lifetime.
Wow.
He truly is.
He is definitely a very, very sweet man. And
I don't know about being the greatest human being. I mean,
well,
I,
no,
I have
that,
to enter
that
your
would
life.
Be like that'd be my dog.
Well, my dog. Dogs are not humans.
Yeah, well, he's my human.
Yes, they are.
He's
my children.
Human. Didn't we have this discussion already, Turtle? Follow along.
Well, don't you remember? I never had a pet. My entire life.
Obviously, he's
a
loner.
Rock.
No.
He is a pet rock.
I am a pet rock.
He is a pet rock.
That'd be funny if we started selling pet rocks with like sideburns.
Oh boy.
That'd be hilarious.
That's like Elvis. Let's talk about your movie Sky, because sure. I hear that is like, it's just killing it right now.
Yeah.
What's going on with it?
Well, I was blessed to meet with Fabian Bertrand, the director, and she saw a lot of girls for this particular role. And Gabrielle Dumont is the producer. It's a character-driven film about Diane Kruger is the star.
And love her.
She's fantastic and more beautiful in person and absolutely lovely and funny. And so I read with the director for over an hour. And she said, I love what you did. And she was crying at the end of the audition, because I had the part memorized pretty much, but I invented something else that she was not expecting. It was supposed to be just a cut and dry bunny girl on the strip who encounters Diane Kruger, but I made her very irreverent, idiosyncratic, and even went as far as I teach her how to roller skate. I decked out all my roller skates with, took me 3.5 hours with rhinestones and crystals, and I made the character hilarious but yet tragic. You know, she's past her prime. She can't get a husband. She's too old. She can't get a boyfriend or a sugar daddy. Obviously, she's lost. She's completely lost, and she's filed Chapter 11 in her head years ago. If you know what I mean, mm-hmm. She's bankrupt emotionally, physically, everything. So as a last resort, she goes on the strip with these two Elvis impersonators. Yeah, so that's how she makes her money. And it's not unlike at the TCL theater, mm-hmm. where you have the impersonators. So they dress me up in a bunny costume, eh? So I have these Elvis impersonators on either side. So we're begging people for money. The funny thing was, the bizarre thing was, that when we shot it in Vegas, that particular scene, they had extras coming up to us and, you know, asking to take a picture with me for $5, $10, $20. But what was happening was there were hundreds and hundreds of people enveloping us that came up and were wanted to take pictures and were giving money. And I kept running after them to give them back the money. But the Elvis impersonators, no, they were grabbing the 20 bucks.
Yeah.
There were more people, 20 times more people that came to take pictures for real. They thought it was for real that we were really doing this, even though there were cameras off, you know, to the side. But so she's a desperate, over-the-hill character who is, she does anything she can to survive at this point, eh? And she's really kind of lost it. And she's, like I say, she's tragic, but, and she lives from moment to moment. And her and Diane meet in Las Vegas, and they become very good friends. And I teach her how to roller skate, and we spend a lot of time together. And then I become obsessed with her. You know, obsessed. She's a few years younger than I am, and I have never met anybody like this person, Romy. Her name is Romy, and she's running from her husband, who she killed, or so you think. They're on a road trip, and it's a fantastic story. I mean, it is just amazing, the story written by Gabrielle and Fabian Bertrand. And I love it that it was female producers, directors. There were one or two male producers. But what they did, which I love about indie films, is they gave me the artistic, creative, and dramatic license to alter the convention of grammar as we know it. Like in big budget pictures, you've got to stick to the script.
Right.
In this one, in the indie movies that I've been doing, they throw out the window the pre-existing text and let you come up with a character, build a character from a skeleton, and let me invent. I love inventing characters. I'm in awe that they hired me for this role, and it's a great part. And they had a they had a rap party that I went to before they all went back to France, and Diane was there, and a lot of people were there. And when Diane's stuff was up, everybody was there, and she was watching it. But when my stuff came up on the bench, when you first see me walking and sitting down on the bench, it's insanely funny. It just is. I ran out of the room. I ran outside, and the producer came running out and said, "You're amazing in this. You're astonishing, beyond astonishing. You have to come in." I said, "I can't watch myself on film.
I have a hard time doing that, too.
You're the same way. Mm-hmm. People say, "Which man are you? So stupid. You, what is the matter? Why can't you watch yourself?" I can't watch myself. I've never been. I've done 28 feature films, and I cannot, for the life of me, look at myself. I always probably think, maybe I could have, should have done this better or different, mm-hmm. or I don't like the way I look. I do not like the way I look at all, ever. So what is your experience?
I'm the exact same way. Every time I see myself on screen, I'm, you know, critiquing everything about my performance, and I do a lot of stunts as well. And,
same here.
You know, so I'm always like, you know, what happened here? Why isn't there a connection here? You know, the other actors, I'm just, you know, critiquing far too much.
Have you always been that way?
Yeah, I've been acting since I'm 7, so I've had a lot of
films.
Yeah, five years.
Yeah,
I can watch myself all the time.
And that's all he does. He like takes, you know, the camera. After this, he'll take the camera home and he'll just like, fawn over himself.
Yeah,
it's disgusting.
I'll just be like, man, my sideburns look really good right there.
So you can't watch yourself either, right?
Nope.
You know, Orson Welles couldn't do that either.
Well, I don't blame him.
And my dear friend Marlon Brando, because I lived with his son Christian Brando for many years, he had the same issue as well. So I don't think it's an anomaly, like some people say, you're nuts or why can't you watch it? They tried to drag me in. Everybody tried to drag me in, and when I couldn't until it was over that segment, and then I went back in. I got a standing ovation from everybody, but I there's something I can't do.
You know, I think that when what the audience doesn't understand is that we become these characters,
hide behind
for
them.
For that time period that we're filming. So you know, I'm no longer Max, and you know, I take on this personality, mm-hmm. and watching it takes me back to that. And, you know, sometimes those roles I don't want to go back to. So, you know, I'd prefer to not see it. And last weekend I went to a screening of a new film, Smoke-Filled Lungs, that I did. And
what is it called?
Smoke-Filled Lungs.
Where can I see this?
It'll be out very soon.
Smoke-Filled Lungs.
Yes, very, very soon, I believe.
What do you play in it?
I play Dallas. I'm a kind of a stripper gone bad.
That must have been
a drug dealing
hard
stripper
with that figure and that face.
Thank you very much. So you know, it's a fight scene. There's Nickelodeon stars, kids that I'm working with, and it was difficult to shoot. And
why?
Well, just you know, the action parts, working with an actor who really had never done stunts before, so trying to get the stunts down was hard for him.
Don't you love doing stunts?
I love it.
Me too.
I love it.
I've
if I can fall
stunts.
Out of something or run through a burning building, you know, I'm a happy girl. Now, to sit in front of a campfire, that's another story. I don't like that.
Why?
I don't like, you know, flames. I don't.
I am the flames of passion.
Yeah. And in The Wendigo, I have to do that. And like, they had to talk me through, like, you know, okay, everything's going to be fine. I'm like, no.
So are you afraid of fire?
I am. I'm afraid of fire.
How about running through fire?
Running through fire, I'm fine. I'm fine because it's continual motion. But,
right.
You know, if I'm sitting in front of it and there's people throwing things on a fire, that scares me.
Oh, that's interesting.
Yeah.
The things that you learn here on The Experience.
Oh, also in Sky, if I may interject, it stars Norman Reedus.
Oh, really?
From The Walking Dead.
God, I love Norman Reedus.
Hubba hubba. You know, the guy on the motorcycle? He is fantastic. He's amazing. Lena Dunham also is in it, and Lou Diamond Phillips and myself, and a few other people.
Lena Dunham,
she created Girls, producer, star of Girls.
Yeah, I love that show.
Yeah.
She's in it, huh?
She's a doll,
yeah. Yeah, she seems like one, while I'm watching it, you know, I'm watching girls, I'll go like behind the scenes or whatever, and she's like talking, and she's a very confident woman.
Oh, she's incredibly smart.
Yeah.
Too, for such a young girl.
Yeah. She's dating the guy from Neon Trees, I think. I think that's her boyfriend.
Really?
Right now. Yeah. Things you learn.
Things you learn.
Thank you so much for coming on the show. Really thank appreciate you. It. Hopefully you had a great time. Are we forgetting anything to that
Syndicate is so Smashers?
Oh, Syndicate Smashers. Right. That's out now as well.
Oh, Samurai Cop. I'm so sorry. I just finished 5 movies back to back. Samurai Cop was one of them.
Okay.
Deadly Are you the Vengeance. Samurai? Samurai Cop 2. Deadly Vengeance. No, I'm not. No, I play a Detective Higgins in it.
I love it.
And show up in my Hundra costume in different scenes for why I don't know, but I just do.
It happens.
It's directed by my favorite director, Gregory Hatanaka. I adore him. I love him. I just finished starring in Syndicate Smashers Benny Tanjara and Doug Tochioka and the incredibly talented Mel Novak. One of the greatest actors, a treasure, one of our national treasures is Mel Novak. So please go see it. It's coming out soon. They've already got a distributor, and we just did the reshoots on that, and I'm still doing reshoots on Syndicate Smashers. And I've got two movies coming up. One I cannot say, but the other's called, I have a co-starring role in When the Storm God Rides. It's a Western.
Oh, nice.
I can't wait because I love horses.
Me too.
Ride horses. You ride horses?
I do.
Jump, ride Western and English. I made 4 movies on horseback, Hundra, Yellow Hair, America 3000. And this one, it's a fantastic script. It is amazing. It's from a novel by Thomas E. Kelly. Mm-hmm. And it is incredible. I play Miss Josephine, a saloon owner, and I get to do a lot of stunts in it, like
oh,
you love
great.
To do,
yeah.
Max. And I'm very excited about this movie, and so blessed at my age to be have a resurgence, if you will, of my career, because there was a spot time where, you know, things weren't happening. You know, I was writing and making a lot of money writing, but in the last 4 or 5 months, I've been working back to back to back to back, and like I said, I have 2 movies lined up, but by the grace of God, this has happened. There's no other explanation.
Well, it's your talents. That's what's
thank
leading.
You.
So thank you so much for coming on. We will have a link to your IMDb as well as your Facebook and all your other social sites. So for more information, make sure to log on to entertheshell.com. I want to play another Dead Good, but at the same time, I want to play a White Pulp. Okay, we'll play a Dead Good song.
Okay.
I want to do Room 106. We're going to do that song. And then when we come back, we're going to actually have the Dead Good on. It's been a while since they've been on the show, so it's always fun to catch up. That's one of the things I always love about the show, especially lately. Now we're starting to get some people that have been on the show a long time ago and that are starting to come back. They were on episode 15.
Wow.
And this is episode 33.
Wow.
So it's always interesting to see the arc from then to now.
Right. And we would love to have you back too.
Oh, thank you so much. Thank you very much for having
so
me.
So fascinating.
Maybe in episode 69.
Turtle, you're just a dog.
Thank you so much for having me on. I am very, very grateful. Thank you.
Thank you.
Please go to Loreen Landon IMDb.
And we'll have all the links. Here is the Dead Good with Room
1. And go look up Max if you want to have a heart attack.
I thought you were going to say hard on.
But that's hey, now. Yeah, that too. Turtle.